I want to welcome you to this worship service online. My name is Pastor Matt from Lord of Life Church, and I'm so thankful you have tuned in to worship with us. Today, we're going to explore reaching and loving Generation Z. These are people age 6 through 21. The Lord loves all ages and all generations, and today we're going to specifically talk about this generation and ways that we can reach them for Christ. It applies to all of us because we know people in that age group. We'll also unite our hearts in prayer. We'll sing to the Lord. We'll hear scripture read to us. We'll receive a blessing. Here are a few announcements as we get started. First off, we believe that prayer is critical and essential to the Christian walk, for our closeness with God and our unity with each other. So I invite you to submit a prayer request online at lolchurch.net. Click on prayer request, submit the prayer request, and we will pray for you this week. Also, Awana is our program during the school year on Wednesday evenings for children, ages preschool through fifth grade. And registration has started. Families have already registered, and I encourage you to register your children or grandchildren by visiting our website, lolchurch.net. You'll see the big banner, Awana, and then click on that, submit the form, and you'll be registered for Awana starting September 8th. And finally, I encourage you to give to the Lord to support the work of God's kingdom here on earth. We give because God first gave to us his amazing grace in Jesus Christ. And I encourage you to put your faith to the test, to say, "Here, Lord, use this. It's yours. The first fruits of what you've given me, use it for your purposes." When we give, we put aside the idols of this world and we put God first. So I encourage you to give to support the work of Lord of Life Church by visiting our website, lolchurch.net. Click on Give in the upper right-hand corner, and there you'll be prompted to give a one-time gift. You can also click on Login in the right-hand corner of the Give page, and there you'll be prompted to log in or set up an account where you can set up a recurring gift. And you can give by mail. Simply mail your gift to P.O. Box 251, Wasco, Illinois, 60183. And your gift will reach the church. And finally, you can give securely and conveniently by text. Simply text this number, 630-381-1199. Type the word give, and you'll be prompted to give a one-time or a recurring gift to the Lord. I'm so thankful for your support. God is using our church to reach people here and around the world, to reach Generation Z. And I'm so thankful for how the Holy Spirit inspires us to bring the good news of Christ to the future generations and the generations of today. May the Lord bless our work. Let's now unite our hearts in prayer. Would you please pray with me? Lord God, thank you so much for your goodness and your grace. Lord, we thank you that your gospel has reached one generation after another. And Lord, we pray that you would use us mightily to reach all generations, specifically Generation Z, for your kingdom. So thank you, God, for what you're doing here and around the world to bring eternal salvation into the hearts of all people. We pray, Lord, that we would do our part, that we would be bold in our witness, that we would be strong in our convictions, and that we would be generous in giving grace. Thank you, Lord, for the cross of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the empty tomb. Thank you that you have removed the barriers, and we can now know you and have a relationship with you, the one true God. So, Lord, we invite you into this worship service. We pray that you heal our world of COVID-19. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. We now sing to the Lord.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is a God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice! beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood, bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Sorrows carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. He's turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice.
Psalm 78, verses 1 through 8. O my people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, what we have heard and known, what our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power and the wonders he has done. He decreed the statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded for our forefathers to teach their children, so the next generation will know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children, when they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. They would not be like their forefathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him.
Mark chapter 9, verses 33 through 37. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, what were you arguing about on the road? But they kept quiet, because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, if anyone wants to be the first, he must be the very last and the servant of all. He took a little child and had him stand among them. Taking him in his arms, he said to them, whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes, and whoever will welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me.
Please join me in prayer. Father, thank you for working in our lives to draw us nearer to you. Give us your love for others. Help us to see and understand what is important to you and make it important to us too. Holy Spirit, teach, guide, remind, convict, and lead us. In Jesus' name, amen. My name is Brian Zilke. I'm the Director of Discipleship at Lord of Life. and it's a privilege to have this opportunity to share this message with you. Today, I'm going to preach about loving and reaching our kids and youth, known as Generation Z, for Christ. But first, I want to say thank you on a personal level to so many of you who have prayed for and encouraged me and my family in this season of grief that we're in since the passing of my dad on July 8th. The cards and the hugs, the love and support we've felt has been incredible. So from the bottom of our hearts, thank you so much. We're grieving with hope and with confidence and joy because as Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. I know that my dad is in heaven with Jesus right now, and I know that I will see him again because of Jesus' resurrection. Isn't that what life is really all about? About knowing Jesus and having eternal life in him? Life here on earth is short. Moments like these for me bring so much clarity and purpose. What I'm going to eat for lunch, or what I'm going to wear, or who wins the game, or what kind of car I drive, they don't matter, do they? So much of our energy each day can be spent on trivial things that don't last. But in moments of loss, whether it's the death of a loved one, the loss of a job or a home, the loss of an ability or a familiar routine, in moments of loss, the temporary nature of things comes into focus. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus preached, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but instead store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." To make it personal or to bring it home, I have to ask myself, what is it that I treasure most? What do I value? And for you, where is your treasure? Whatever it is, that's where your heart is. That's what your life is centered around. And is it something that will fade away and disappoint? Or is it something or someone that will never fail you and will last forever? There's only three things in this world that we know last forever. God himself, God is eternal. His word is also eternal and lasts forever. And the third thing is, it's everyone created in the image of God, in his likeness. No matter what age, color, tribe, language, nation, or beliefs. Isaiah the prophet wrote, "All men are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God stands forever." Our life on earth is like grass. After this life here, our souls will endure for eternity, either forever with the Lord in heaven in his presence for those who have received Christ, or apart from him in hell for those who have rejected Jesus as Savior. Jesus is the only way, the only truth, and the only life, which is not a popular stance, but it's what he claimed and it's the truth. So it's what Christians believe and what we proclaim. Even during his ministry on earth, many of Jesus' disciples deserted him because of his hard teachings. John wrote, "From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him." "You don't want to leave me too," Jesus asked the 12. Simon Peter answered, "Lord, to whom should we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." There's nowhere else to go. Jesus alone has the words of eternal life. I open with all that because it's where I'm at personally, but also it helps us start to think about what's important in life and to realign our priorities. It helps us to keep the main thing the main thing. And I firmly believe that having a biblical, eternal perspective on our lives will lead us to care about, love, and invest in the most important relationships, our relationship with God and our relationships with other people. That's why we've made it our mission as a church to connect people with Jesus and each other. It's why we exist. It's what we seek to do in everything that we do. Now, I've been on staff at Lord of Life since 2003. Fresh out of college, single, living with my parents, and I was hired back then to lead and direct youth ministries. At that time, I was basically still a kid myself. So there wasn't a big age gap, and I could still relate to and understand what the youth were going through, since times and technology hadn't really changed too much since I was their age. But since those days, a lot has changed. I no longer have hair. I'm not cool anymore. Not that having hair made me cool. I don't care about being cool anymore. I'm married now with 4 kids on my own, and I still live at my parents' house. No, not really. I'm just kidding about that. But the point is, I've been doing this for a long time, almost 20 years in youth ministry, and lots has changed. Our kids today are growing up in a different world than I grew up in, and that maybe you grew up in. When Pastor Matt asked me to preach and gave me the freedom to choose a topic, I prayed for God's guidance, and it dawned on me that I've never preached a sermon about how to love and reach our kids and our youth. So that's what I want to do today. At times, I'll refer to today's kids and youth as Generation Z. Members of Gen Z are those born between 2000 and 2015. This puts the age group for Gen Zers in the range of 6 to 21 years old. They're school-age students. They're the largest demographic in the world, comprising 32% of the global population, and already the largest media audience in our nation. This sermon could obviously go in a lot of different directions, but for today, my goal is to help encourage relational bridge building across generational gaps by conveying some timely trends and some timeless truths. This is not an apologetic sermon with all the answers to all the questions that kids and youth ask about the Christian faith. My prayer is that today will be a starting point or a checkpoint on the path for all of us towards greater love, better understanding, and stronger connections with our young people. Now, I realize that there are also young people hearing me too, and I pray that you will make the same efforts to love, understand, and connect with the adults in your life, your parents and grandparents, your neighbors, teachers, coaches, and of course, your church. You are not the church of tomorrow, as some may say. You are not the next generation. It doesn't matter how young or how old you are, you belong to the church of today. We are all part of the now generation in God's sight. And Jesus made it clear that his kingdom includes children. Kids don't have to wait until they grow up to be significant in the church. When it comes to reaching kids, our love leads us to sacrifice. If you've been a parent, you probably remember a period of your life when all that you seemed to watch were animated, G-rated movies. Now, personally, I've come to enjoy a lot of these movies because of their adult references and their hidden humor that snuck in for parents. But the sacrifice isn't only about what you watch or what you can't watch. It's all the other things you can't do anymore. Parents can't just go off and do whatever they want on a whim whenever they want. My wife tells me how she feels that she has to ask permission to even go to the bathroom or take a shower, let alone having unrestricted free time. Now, for her and for us, that just seems unheard of, a freedom and a luxury that parents sacrifice out of love. Or is it obligation? No, it's definitely love for their children. My dad was really good at it. He was a handyman, and he was very generous in many ways with his time and his resources and his money. Family, friends, neighbors, and church members all knew they could call my dad, and he would show up to help fix whatever was broken. Now, before we bought our house, when Emily and I first got married, my dad walked through it with me. It's an old house built well over 100 years ago, and at that time it was in disrepair and severely outdated. The previous owners were elderly and unable to keep it up, so it was for sale as is. My wife Emily loved it for its charm, its woodwork, fireplace, the front porch. My dad advised us not to buy it, saying, "It will nickel and dime you to death." I already said our house, so you know we went against my dad's advice. We went with my wife Emily's heart over my dad's head. But you know what? My dad never brought it up again. Never once said, "I told you so." And there were plenty of opportunities, believe me. Nope, he just showed up with his tools and oftentimes with the supplies already purchased for our project and he put in countless days and hours of difficult, dirty work over the years to help me. Now, he was right about our house, but he was also wrong. It didn't nickel and dime us to death because he provided the nickels and the dimes, saving us so much money. And I wouldn't trade the time I got to work with my dad for anything. I'm so glad that we bought our old house. Moral of the story, always side with your wife's heart. No, wait. The real point of the story is my dad's sacrificial love for us. Even when he became physically unable to help because of his lung disease, he was always still available to call or FaceTime when I needed advice or I just wanted to tell him what projects I was working on. That kind of sacrificial love is at the core of God's heart for us. Jesus displayed his incredible love by sacrificing himself, by giving up his life, suffering and dying on the cross, and rising again, defeating death, so that you and I might live with him eternally. And when it comes to raising our kids, we're also willing to defer our desires to do what's best for our children, even if it means not having what we want at that time. And our extended Christian family is no different in the church. Young believers may not be our biological children, but they're also ours at the same time. Our sacrifices as a church reveal our priorities. If we truly love young people, we'll do whatever it takes to help them know Christ. One of our top goals as a church right now, as prayerfully determined by our governing board, is to create an irresistible youth experience. Now, what does that mean and what does that look like? Is it trying to be cool and flashy and entertaining and enticing? Well, yes, fun and games does help as a draw for youth, but we can't out-entertain the world. There's Netflix and video games and all these addictive apps that have been developed for phones, and they've got us beat when it comes to big budgets and marketing. But that's okay, because that's not our best play. The thing that no one can compete with us, the church, on is our mighty God and our life-saving message about the good news of Jesus Christ. Because of who he is and what he's done, we're motivated and moved by him to love each other in ways the world doesn't understand and cannot offer. We acknowledge our sin and our need for a Savior. We know repentance and grace and forgiveness of sins, humility and sacrifice, prayer and power to overcome the world, only through Christ at work in us, his church. It's our connections, it's our relationships with him and each other that stand out. Now, if you're a believer, think about who prayed for you and who helped you come to know the Lord. If you're not a believer, the fact that you're here now listening to me tells me that God is at work and that you have someone who's praying for you to know him. For me, it was certainly my parents, my grandma and extended family. It was my pastors and my Sunday school teachers and VBS leaders and youth leaders, but it was also the overall collective community of believers at the church. I even remember visiting my grandma at her church too. She was part of a quilters group that met in the church basement. I remember the musty smell going into that old building, but even more than that, I remember the ladies' excitement when we would come. They were so happy to see some kids. This summer, my oldest daughter, Mabel, started coming to our Quilters of the King group here at Lord of Life. She's learned how to make a pillow. But the coolest thing is how she feels welcome and how she has formed relationships with the ladies of the group. Last week, I received a text from one of the ladies sharing how Mabel had told her about her upcoming week at camp and how Mabel was feeling nervous. So the ladies gathered around Mabel and prayed for her to grow in all ways in God's will. I responded to the text by saying, "Thank you for praying for and encouraging her. That is so cool and formational for Mabel to feel part of our cross-generational family as a church, and I love it." The reality is, we don't parent our kids for long, and we only get one chance to guide them through their elementary, middle, and high school years. The season just passes so quickly, and it requires intentionality. While true for biological children, it's also true for the young people in our church family. Generation Z is facing spiritual, emotional, intellectual, and moral challenges like no prior generation. They face more temptation at the bus stop in the morning than their grandpa did at their age on a Friday night going out to town looking for trouble. Temptation is for them at a young age just one click away. It's looking for them. It's certainly a challenge for the kids and youth and for us too, for all of us together as the church. Research reveals that young people in America are leaving the Christian church at an unprecedented rate. A variety of studies report that 50 to 70% of young Christians walk away from the church by the time they're in their college years. Even those who don't leave find themselves struggling to believe Christianity is true. But there's still hope. Most young people who leave the church are still interested in spiritual things. They're not lost causes. They're willing to listen if we will listen first. In fact, the act of listening is at the core of the solution. Young people have questions. They're seeking reasonable explanations and authentic relationships. Are we willing to be available to answer the call? God calls us to truth and relationship. Not one or the other. Both are needed. And God demonstrates the perfect balance between justice and mercy, between law and gospel. John tells us that Jesus is full of grace and truth. In other words, Jesus is the master and perfect example. He loved children and youth. He rebuked his disciples for preventing children from coming to him. He still wants kids close. He treasures them. Some scholars of the Bible believe that Jesus' disciples may have been teenagers themselves, which basically makes him a youth leader. Peter is the only one that we know to have been married, and Matthew records in chapter 17, 24 to 27, that Jesus was with his disciples going into Capernaum, but only paid the temple tax for himself and Peter, not all 12. And the tax was required of every male who was 20 years and older. So think about it. The rest of them could have been teenagers. So Jesus loves kids and youth and exhibits the importance of truth and relationship. We must be willing to take the initiative to build relationships with Gen Zers, letting them know by our words and actions that you matter to me. I care about you. I will sacrifice to invest in your life to help you be all that God has designed you to be. Relationships are the runway on which truth lands. We prepare them for truth by showing we care and by gaining their trust. So what can we do to love and reach Generation Z? First of all, make a commitment. Each of us in our own small way can contribute to the important work of encouraging young people if we'll simply commit ourselves to the task. It can be as easy as smiling and greeting a young person. It can be serving in LOL Kids. You see, I'm wearing my LOL Kids yellow shirt today that our volunteer teams wear. Or serving in our youth ministries. We have exciting fall programs starting up soon, and we're looking for more volunteers. please contact me. My email is on the screen if you're interested in learning more. Second, if you have kids or have the privilege of being around kids, start early. According to statistics, young Christians decide to abandon the church long before they tell anyone, and usually before they leave the home of their parents. That's why it's so important for us to start early, even before your kids are verbalizing their questions. Make your home, or your car, your dinner table, the bedroom, make them all safe places to raise questions and to talk about God. Don't assume that they'll eventually get their questions answered from just listening to sermons or from attending youth group. We must start much earlier. Start the conversations with your kids before they're confronted with the issues elsewhere. Third, take on the tough issues. Why does science seem to contradict the claims of Christianity? Why would an all-powerful God, all-loving God, allow so much evil and suffering in the world? How can I be sure Jesus really rose from the grave? If Christianity is true, why are so many Christians hypocrites? Why is the history of Christianity filled with so much violence? Why should I care about any of these things to begin with? Are you ready to answer these difficult questions? Most of us aren't. But these are precisely the kinds of questions we need to be prepared to answer if we want to help young people find the truth and follow Jesus. And don't be intimidated. God is bigger than any of these objections, and each question can be answered. Next, be patient with yourself if you don't seem to have all the right answers, or if the young people you're leading don't seem to be progressing as quickly as you might like. Stick with it. Do your homework. Speak truth. Love young people and trust God's timing. Last, stay balanced. When people don't believe something we know to be true, it's easy to lean more towards a proclamation of truth rather than building relationship. Don't give in to that inclination. Our challenge is to avoid tilting our approach too far in either direction. When we truly love someone, we aim to understand that person. It takes time and effort. If we want to love young people, we must make the commitment to understand them first. We often approach with the demand that they understand us first. So let's humble ourselves. It's more important to understand than to be understood. If we're going to genuinely reach young people, we must have an accurate understanding of what they think and how they feel. Last Sunday, I had the high school youth over to my house. We prayed together and talked about plans for the coming school year. I also asked for their insights about their generation. I asked how they would describe themselves. They said, independent. They're used to figuring out things on their own. They're motivated and feel empowered to take action and to make a difference in the world. They're bold and courageous. Another word they use to describe their generation is accepting. They're acceptance and social justice oriented. Gen Zers are motivated by causes surrounding human equality. Another word they used was stressed. In a cover story for Time magazine, a teenager named Faith Ann described how overwhelming young people feel. We're the first generation that cannot escape our problems at all. We're like little volcanoes. We're getting this constant pressure from our phones, from our relationships, from the way things are today. More than 2 out of 3 teens today feel overwhelmed by everything they need to do each week. Previous generations could usually get away from bullying and peer pressure, at least in part, but with social media, young people find it increasingly difficult, if not impossible, to escape their troubles. The corresponding stress and anxiety, coupled with constant bombardment of information, can be overwhelming. I found more helpful descriptors of Gen Z in a book called So the Next Generation Will Know: Preparing Young Christians for a Challenging World by Sean McDowell and J. Warner Wallace. You already know how I feel about the title, since I don't like referring to them as the next generation, but it's still a really good book. And here are some more words that they use to describe Gen Z. They're digital natives. Some call them screenagers. They spend nearly every waking hour of the day interacting with some form of digital technology. They're the first generation raised by swiping screens before they could speak. Many teens do not view it as rude to have a phone out during a conversation. But before getting upset with them about it, let's try to imagine what it's like to be a young person today. Generation Z are researchers. They're adept at finding their own answers online. They're likely to fact-check parents even during a conversation and pastors during a sermon. They're also individualistic. Whether in terms of religious choice, gender, or morality, young people have grown up in a culture that places the individual as the highest authority. Gen Zers resist judging the moral choices of others, and feelings often trumped facts. Another word to describe them is fluid. Categories that were seemingly fixed and distinct for previous generations are now considered blurry, ambiguous, and fluid. Perhaps nowhere is there greater fluidity than with the issues of sex, gender, marriage, and family. Formerly fixed categories have increasingly broken down in the minds of Gen Z. Another word used to describe them is lonely. Based on their online presence, most teens seem happy, but it's often a veneer hiding deep loneliness. There's a growing mental health crisis of depression among today's students. And finally, transparent. They struggle to know who they can trust. They seek relationships, and they respect transparency. They're less impressed with slick presentations. They can detect exaggerations, inaccuracies, and prideful attitudes. The more vulnerable a person is, the more likely he or she will be trusted. They want to hear personal stories that reveal imperfections and weaknesses because they know that they have similar vulnerabilities themselves. So share both your successes and your failures. You don't have to tell your entire life story, but let them know you can relate by sharing relevant life experiences and struggles. So now that we've looked at some timely attributes common to Gen Z, let's take a moment to examine three timeless truths that we can apply as we interact with them. First, remember that every young person has a unique story, just like you. No one is simply a product of their generation. The trends and characteristics can help us to understand their generation, but not all young people fit into the stereotypes. Second, focus on what we have in common. Yes, we may talk, dress, and act differently, but the reality is that we have much more in common than you might think. And the reason is simple. Regardless of color, age, status, or any other factor, every human being is made in the image of God. We yearn for eternal life. We love stories. We want to belong. We want to be loved and live significant lives. We desire meaningful relationships. It's true for Gen Z, for boomers, for Gen Xers, for millennials, and every other generation who has ever been or ever will be. So rather than focusing on differences, let's focus primarily on what binds us together. And third, stay positive. If you see Gen Zers through a negative lens, how do you think you'll interact with them? Don't dwell on the negative. Instead, rejoice over our kids and relish the opportunity to mentor, guide, teach, and love them. If you feel inadequate, please know that God has equipped you to make an eternal difference with this generation. That's right, God has equipped you. Don't compare yourself to anyone else. Your job and my job is simply to be faithful. Trust that God is the one who ultimately transforms lives, and remember, God will supply us with our needs. Time is short. This generation faces immense challenges, and yet they have unbelievable promise. Now is the time to begin. Forget about yesterday. Don't worry about tomorrow. Today is the day to begin building relational bridges to love and reach Generation Z, our kids, and our youth, so that someday they'll look back and think of you as one of the people who helped them know the Lord. Not only that, God willing, they'll follow your example by loving and reaching the generations to come. Let it be so, Lord. Let it be so. Amen.
Come behold the wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. Be the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, be the perfect Son of Man. In his living, in his suffering, never trace nor stain his sin. See the true and bitter Adam come to save the hellbound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in him we stand. Come behold the wondrous mystery, Christ the Lord upon the tree. In the stead of ruined sinners, he's a lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory. Grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, seen by heaven, the God of life. But no grave could restraining, praise the Lord, he is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance, now unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as he will be when he comes. What a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering. Christ in power resurrected, as he will be when he comes.
As you go out into the world sharing the good news of Jesus with all generations, may you go forward with his blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.